I was 5 years old the first time I was on stage doing my first ever ballet performance. My dream was to be a ballet dancer. I did ballet in high school, and as a teenager, I spent my summers in sweaty dance studios being beaten in my tummy so that I would tighten my muscles. I was told I was too fat. I loved it. Ballet was my first true love. I loved the magic of the theater, to dress up, put on tiaras, the stories about the princess and the princesses, everything, and the pointe shoes, a perfect mixture of pain and grace. These are my very first pointe shoes, and it's a very big day in a little ballet girl's life when she gets those shoes. When I was 17 years old, I made a U-turn. I realized that I wasn't talented enough. I didn't have the right body type. I switched to what was going to be my next passion in life: science, math, and physics. Today, I want to talk to you about challenges that are limiting science. I will tell you why I think science should be more pink. Yes, I love pink and high heels and makeup and the mysteries of the atomic nucleus and the scientific method. I remember my first day as a student in physics at the University of Oslo like it was yesterday. I was wearing a tight, pink, glittery top with my best push-up bra underneath. I had long blonde hair and I was wearing it in braids. I walked into the old physics auditorium at the University of Oslo, and very soon I felt very alone, like I didn't belong. I was the only one wearing a pink top and pink lipstick. But I was just being me, a 19-year-old girl who loved pink and the scientific method at the same time. My fellow students saw only the pink part of me. After I had raised my arm in a class in my second year as a physics student, pointing out a mistake, one of the smartest and loudest physics guys bursted out after class. "But Sunniva, you're not stupid!" Yes. He was so sure that I was stupid. Now he and the rest of the physics students realized that I actually wasn't. So then they started questioning the time I spent on being a girly girl, how long it would take me to pick out an outfit, put on my makeup, you know, spend time on stuff that it's not important. Like if it's not possible to be serious about your physics studies, and also use some brain capacity on superficial stuff. So it's just that I had different interests in addition to the physics. So when they would program or solve more and more difficult equations, I would teach ballet, or I taught math and physics in junior high. I talked to people. They said I was lazy. I'm saying I got a different input. So my dream was to be a dancer, but I became a nuclear physicist. Today, I study the element thorium as an alternative fuel to uranium in nuclear reactors. Why it could be a very good idea, and what challenges we are facing. The Chernobyl accident was actually my way into a major in nuclear science. Is this me? Sorry. The Chernobyl accident, this is the Fukushima accident, got me interested not just in the power that lays in the atomic nucleus, but I went into the Chernobyl accident looking at it with the eyes of a physicist, and only the eyes of physicist Sunniva. But very soon, I realized that I wasn't just interested in the physics, I was almost equally interested and fascinated of the people behind the accident. What did the accident do to the people? And how did that accident happen? And it opened my eyes. When I started looking at it with these different eyes and different perspectives, I saw the importance of interdisciplinarity in science. Because that accident, or maybe most accidents and big things that happens, they're a mixture of different things. It was, for example, the Chernobyl accident. It was a mixture of politics, economy, psychology, sociology, medicine, biology, engineering, and of course physics, and much more. All of them mixed together for, first of all, the accident to happen, and then what has happened the almost 30 years that has gone. And then, well, I was 2 years old when the Chernobyl accident happened, so this I have learned as history, and I've seen it in retrospect. But then in 2011, the Fukushima accident happened, and I got a first-hand experience to how people react. Because me, as a nuclear physicist, I was sort of sitting there in Norway, looking at what's happening in Japan, a really, really devastating natural disaster, killing maybe 20,000 people. No one died from radiation from Fukushima, and it's very, very unlikely that anyone will. Still, almost all the attention was towards what was happening in Fukushima. And what I realize, again, as a nuclear physicist, I'm puzzled, because it's like, but yes, it's a very, very, very grave accident. But still, it's so much worse what's happening around that accident. But there are so many myths about my field of science, how dangerous radiation is, how dangerous nuclear power is, how many will die from radiation. Even Chernobyl, the worst accident ever in the history of nuclear power, less than 100 people died as a direct consequence from that accident, as a direct consequence of radiation. Less than 100 people. No one in Fukushima. But the fear that people are experiencing for radiation is real, even though that fear may be unjust. So there are definitely some challenges here. For me, as a nuclear physicist working on very down to looking at nuclei, the challenges for me is, okay, from sort of, I need to know everything there is to know about these thorium and uranium nuclei so that we can make even better nuclear fuels in the future and even better nuclear power plants. But then there are also these challenges that has to do with the interdisciplinarity and the people, the non-scientists, the non-physicists, because they're part of society and we can't ignore that. There are also very many myths about who is the scientist. It's not her, aka me. Traditionally, scientists are viewed as a little boring or crazy, or if you're lucky, you're both. For many, it is someone that is very difficult to relate to. The scientist in his or her white coat, safely behind a desk, distancing him or her from the rest of society, is not particularly inviting. He or she is someone else, someone who cannot understand real life, not the one you feel you can have like a chat to and listen to and trust. And I think it's human to listen to people you can relate to. What I have discovered is that showing a personal side of me, which for me is very natural, showing that I am human, I mean, it's obvious that I am human, but yeah, showing that, it allows me to communicate in a totally different way. And people listen, even though I say things that for many may be controversial, for example, about radiation. For many, it is controversial to say that actually less than 100 people died directly from radiation in Chernobyl. So I get the privilege of challenging people's views. So this is a tip also to anyone who wants to get a message across. Be honest, show who you are, show your flaws, because it's much more inviting. And also a message to the non-scientists out there, even those scientists who do not show that they are human, they still are, I promise that. So these myths and cultures, they're a problem between the scientist and the non-scientist community. But they're also a problem among scientists themselves. Cultures between scientists that are building walls between us and holding us back. Cultures that are hindering And the communication and cooperation between sciences become very difficult, and it's more difficult than to solve the problems. We have these attitudes that are scaring a lot of good people away from science because you think that you have to be such and such. Like I experienced, that it's the feeling that it's not possible to be a feminine, girly girl and at the same time be into really hardcore science. My fellow students, when I studied physics in my first years, they were right about one thing, though. I do spend some time on figuring out what to wear in the mornings, so and put on my makeup, and what will be my look of the day. And of course, then I do a selfie and put it in the outfit of the day hashtag on Instagram. But that's just me. And I decided to wear this dress 3 weeks ago. 2 weeks ago, I decided what to do with my hair. 2 days ago, when I was packing my bag to go here, I freaked and I had to pack 4 pairs of high heels in addition to the ones that I was traveling in. And I tried on 3 of them now before I was coming here this morning. So yeah, I do spend time in that, but that's just me. I am a scientist, but I'm also a girl. I'm a single mother. I'm a human being. So I guess I'm a piece and a puzzle of what we call society. And I have a passion for shoes, and that's okay. It doesn't make me less of a scientist, right? So who's the scientist? It should be anybody. This is my daughter, Alexandra. She's 4.5 years old. And of course, I want only the best in the world for her. Of course. She's lucky, she's born in Norway, so she has more or less anything she can ever want to. But most little girls and boys, they're not that lucky. A lot of them don't even have clean water. And that's what it really is all about. It's our children and making a better world for our children. And nuclear physics is for me my contribution. I study thorium. I study this element because we can use it to make clean power with substantial less amounts of radioactive waste. That's my contribution. And I truly, truly believe that nuclear power is a good thing. And from everything I know about nuclear power, how it works, how dangerous it is, how risky it is, how ionizing radiation affects us biologically, I cannot understand how it is possible to worry about climate change. I worry about climate change and not be positive towards nuclear. And climate change is happening now. So we have some really big challenges in the world today, climate change being one of the really biggest one. So, but of course also it's health, it's how do you battle Ebola, how do you get clean water to the little children who don't have clean water. So, dear students, if you really want to make the world a better place, please consider a career in science, math, physics, chemistry, biology, medicine. These challenges that we are facing, of course, we need good politics. We need people to work together. But to get that clean water, to get that vaccine, to stop climate change, you need scientific and technological solutions. So please consider that. And we need all kinds of people. That guy, I was so sure I was stupid. He's probably the best programmer I've ever known. He finished his PhD 1 year earlier than he was supposed to. He's not supposed to change. He should be that, sorry to say, the classical nerd. Because you definitely need those kind of people. But I think we need people like me too. Because why should science be more pink? Should science be pink? Yes, science should be pink. And I'm not really talking about the color, even though I like the color pink. Pink is a state of mind. It's about being, for me, feminine, a girly girl, but respected and not judged. It's about balance, diversity, and democracy. Maybe I, as a woman, embracing my femininity, being a single mother of Alexandra, bring different perspectives into science than, again, sorry to say it, the classical male nerd. It's not like we should paint the old physics auditorium pink or that everyone should wear high heels and boas. We need a diversity. We need people with different backgrounds, and that means different sexes, different ethnicities, different interests, people with different hopes and dreams, and different experiences, different perspectives and skills. And it's not okay if you think that it's not suiting to be feminine and into science, because science in some way is by definition non-feminine. When did it become non-feminine to work for a better world? I have broken some laws or some conventions, and this has actually made me meet different people from different sciences, and they have widened my horizon, and they have challenged me, and I've seen the potential that really is there. I wish it wasn't so that I had to get a master's degree in physics and aced it before I actually dared to be pink, because the judgment I met my first year at university, before I'd finished this master's degree and sort of proved that I belonged there, it almost made me quit. I felt so alone and so not in the right place. And people believed I was stupid. Then I started to believe I was stupid too, because it's really hard not to believe that when other people actually think you are. So I was this close to quitting, but I didn't, probably because I'm stubborn. And today I see that being different, being pink, is actually making me stronger, because different people listen to me, and maybe because they can relate to me, and I get to challenge their views, but they also challenged my maybe narrow-minded view on science. And if you're still not convinced, pinks do care, of course. So allowing me to be pink opened my eyes. It opened my eyes to the hinders that are there in science. A certain identity is there, and it's hindering communication and the interdisciplinarity. And it's building walls for cooperation that we need in science to bring the world forward. I'm still really scared when I'm about to talk in nuclear conferences, because also there, I want to be me. I want to wear my heels and my pink lipstick. And I am scared that they will judge me based on the height of my heels, even though, of course, I know it is possible to do both. But a lot of them out there are still not convinced. So finally, I have a request for my fellow scientists out there, my fellow people working in academia. Can we please get our heads up from the sand, respect each other, do science without borders? I believe that's when we'll be able to do the truly great things. I have broken some laws, and I know it can be very rough, but it's worth it. Thank you.